stole my thunder about age jokes. So, but yes, the reason we are doing this is it was striking that we had some very senior architects at our last event and giving some very perspectives based on a lot of experience. But we know that one of the things that the AEA is trying to do is to build a profession of enterprise architecture and be the professional body for practicing enterprise architects. And there are a lot of people younger than those who were on the set last time around. So we thought what we would try and do today is not only get a younger perspective, but also a somewhat regional perspective, the view from Spain. So that we're trying to kind of achieve both those things with this session, and we've had a lot of help in putting this together from the local chapter of the Association of Enterprise Architects. So first person I'd like to ask up and join me is Juan Abal, who is the chair of the local chapter here in Madrid. He's been very helpful in putting it together, so welcome, Juan. Have a seat wherever you would like. Next, Mario Gomez Valesco is one of our young enterprise architects, so come join me. Welcome. Danielle Aguado Perez. Thank you, Danielle. And Ignacio Macias Jareño. I'm doing my best with the names, but thank you for putting up with me. We were due to have one other panelist with the hardest name to pronounce, so unfortunately she can't be with us and I don't have to embarrass myself with her name. But apparently it's not just me, she's from the north and the names are harder up there. So anyway, I'm going to, rather than have me introduce these folk, they're going to introduce themselves, say a little bit about who they are and what they do. And we'll start with Juan, if we may.
Well, as you can see, I'm not one of the young practitioners, but I'm here because I am the president of the Spanish chapter. And well, I have been working in IT for all my life, that it's a lot of years now. And first as the professor at university, very, very good years, that. And then working for the Spanish administration, also I know very well the Spanish administration, and then working for IBM. And during the last years, I have been working in enterprise architecture in Spain, in Europe, and in Latin America, in big projects. And well, I try to train and to mentor young architects to follow this career and to show them what it's all about and how they can progress in their careers. So I'm very concerned and involved in this training of young architects to follow this career. So then maybe that's also why I'm here in this panel.
Yes. Absolutely, absolutely. Shall we work down, Daniel?
Yeah, no, I have.
Oh, you've got it.
My name is Daniel. I have 2 years experience in the IT world because I'm 26 years old. And I started in the IT architect career now. And I am knowing this fantastic world, and I hope to be able to grow in this area. I am focused on cloud computing right now, and I started as in an internship program, learning about cloud computing. And now I am trying to grow in the cloud architect career.
Thank you, Mario.
Hi, my name is Mario Gomez. Currently I work in IBM. I joined IBM 6 years ago. My first role was an application architect for financial service sector, specifically in payment area. And now I'm infrastructure architect, and I'm very, very interested in this enterprise architect role because I studied business and finance at this is a mix between IT and business, I think. Thank you.
And hello, my name is Ignacio Macias. I joined IBM approximately 6.5 years ago. I joined IBM as a graduate training program. I did about 2 or 3 years as a system administrator working with VMware. And for the last, let's say, 3 years, I've been working as an IT infrastructure architect. I've been working mainly in new proposals, new engagements, in part in the outsourcing part. And I'm also part of the, let's say, the lead architect in two contracts inside of IBM in strategic outsourcing. And I'm interested in this event mainly because I work a lot with the infrastructure part, and more I'm starting to see that I used to think that the infrastructure was the most important thing, but I'm seeing more and more now that we need to get closer to the business and that what's really important is the business.
Okay, I think we'll hear more about that later, but thank you all for the introductions. So, as we've heard, we've got some experience. Some of you have more than others experience of architecture work, and maybe started with an IT background. So, what did you know about architecture when you started your current job? Anything that you'd learned, or did you even know about it beforehand through university or your past? Anyone who wants to have a go at that one?
Well, I started computer engineering, so I don't know about the rest of the countries, but in Spain, computer engineering is all about developing and programming. So you could have a little bit of architecture, but very, very little, and very far from enterprise architecture.
As we said, I studied business and finance, and for me, architect it was an analyzing system or something like that.
I didn't know this role in the university. I studied computer science and I didn't have any subject about business, about financing, about economical themes. And I didn't know the architect role. And even when I started at IBM, I didn't know this role. It's a few months ago when I started to know what this role does and what's important is this role for an enterprise, for a company.
And Juan, you obviously started doing other things and then moved into architecture.
Yes,
so
well, it was since the beginning, mostly because it's in the situation in Spain is quite... is not very good about architecture. In fact, there are engineers, and there are some studies about engineering, all class of engineers, but there is not a computer science curricula like this, like in other countries. The most similar to computer science was what I did many years ago, that was from physics to computing, and it was like computer science, but it's no longer available. Now we have the engineers, and all they learn is programming and designing system, but not from an architectural point of view. And in fact, from the Spanish chapter, we started a study last year about the situation of the architecture and the enterprise architecture in the Spanish universities, what they think about that, if they are interested or not. And unfortunately, we discovered that a few of them were interested in enterprise architecture. And this is the real situation. So it's quite difficult for people that want to be an architect or IT architect or enterprise architect to have a clear idea about what is this role, where they can begin, where are the studies that they can do in the university or in other places. And this is something that we have to change.
Well, that whole point about how do I get into enterprise architecture and what's the career path for architects, how do I best prepare myself, that's something that not unique to Spain. That's probably the most common thing that we get asked at the AEA around the world is how do I do
ask a question to the audience about what do you think is the best career for an enterprise architect, and there were not a consensus. Someone said that the best is some engineer because you are used to rules and the proceedings and the budgets and so on. Others said, no, it's better software engineer because you know about applications, about IT. There are no consensus. So I think this is something that we have to think about and to develop to set a more clear path for enterprise architecture.
Right. So how did you get into enterprise? What I heard, I think, was that you didn't have an opportunity to learn much about enterprise architecture at university. So you started a job and you start to hear about it. Is it you get a taste of it on one project, or is there in your organization, is there a career, a path for architects right now? Or how did you, as individuals, land up starting to be interested in architecture?
I think that to be an architect is more an attitude that a job preference or a role preference. No, because an architect has to be worried about an overview of everything that is involved in our project or is involved in this case in a company. Mm-hmm. And there are people that is not so worried about the overview, if not in the but in the deep of a theme of a part of the project. So in my case, I like to know the overview of more things or many things more than a specific part of an enterprise or of a project. So I started in the architect role for this.
Those reasons.
Reason, yes.
Okay. Mario? How did you first do architecture or find your way into architecture?
Yeah. In my current company, IBM, it was an enterprise architect role, but it's necessary a lot of years to knowledge to access this kind of role, and for me it's a very long view for I can access to enterprise architect, is my opinion.
Well, in my case, I was working as a system administrator, so I kind of got a little bit bored, or I saw it was a repetitive task, at least. So I wanted to face new challenges. So the architect role appeared, and at the start, I saw it was quite challenging. I saw a lot of things, a lot of challenges. But after all, it's something that I like to do. I like to have a greater view. I like to see how everything works from start to the end. Before, I used to only see a little part of the whole system, we could say, and that's the part I like.
And have you had any training opportunities specific to architecture? Is it on-the-job training, or are there certifications or other mentoring, anything like that, that you've been able to take advantage of inside your organization at this point? Any training as an architect, for example? Or?
Yes, we have a career framework for this, and I think that mentoring is a very good point for everything, for any learning plan. But for architect, it's difficult to have a specific address to get this role, because you have to know about many things. Mm-hmm. And for example, for enterprise architect, you have to know the business of an industry, and it's difficult to learn about this from the IT provider point of view, because it's difficult to reach the business processes, to know the business direction, these kind of points that you need to be a good enterprise architect. I think that if we could involve in a client company or in another industry company that that let us to see the direction of their business process, mm-hmm. we could learn more about this role and we could grow in this area more properly.
And Juan, is that a role that the local chapter can help play, do you think? Some mentoring and some sharing of experience from those who have been practicing?
Yes, this is one of the main objectives, is to create awareness about enterprise architecture and to show the young people from the universities or from any company that where they are working at to show them how they can follow this path, what they have to do in terms of training, in terms of mentoring, also in terms of what projects, in what sectors, because they need some guidance. Until now, we have had very difficult days, mm-hmm. you know, all the crisis and so on, but we are starting now with more interest, and this is something that we feel from our company, that they are getting more interest in enterprise architecture, and this is a good chance to go in this field, but for these young people, they need some guidance. And this is something that from our Spanish chapter we are trying to do. We also have plans for webinars, not only related to one concept, but also for the career, to show them how they can start and how they can progress in this career in these different companies where they are. This is some of our main. And one of the main values resources for training is mentoring, is stay with a senior architect trying to learn from him or from her and be a shadow or be something like that, because if not, it's quite difficult to learn. It's very complex to learn, but if you learn from someone that has practiced for many years, it's very easy and it's a very convenient way to learn.
In my case, I did a program training course called Architectural Thinking, but in this course is more focusing to resolve the business requirement and not understand the business requirement, I think.
Right. Okay. Well, in my case also I did the same that Mario did, but in my case what happened is I did it before start doing my role, so...
Right.
I did the course, I didn't understand a lot, and now if I would redo the course, I think I would understand
would
a lot
more. To you. Yeah, yeah. So one of the things I'm hearing is that the role of enterprise architect in Spain is still relatively, I don't know, new, but relatively rare, and maybe it's a few larger organizations that have those roles. Do you think there's anything that we can do at the Open Group or the AEA to help spread awareness, or do you think there's a movement already starting to build? You mentioned, Juan, that you feel there's some more interest inside your organisation, but is it shared in, say, a typical Spanish company?
No, really, we are receiving requests from the Spanish companies about enterprise architects to work with them and to make some consulting services. And this is something new for us, because there were only the big ones and not very convinced also, but we are now receiving more requests from our clients about enterprise architecture. So I think that this is because the work of the Open Group of the Association of Enterprise Architects is something is changing, and I think it's changing for the good.
I think I heard Fernando say earlier that enterprise architectural approach isn't really an optional thing anymore. It's you've really got to do it. So if that's if that reflects a feeling here as well, then I'm sure it's going to take off. So would you see that there needs to be a for the Spanish businesses, the Spanish organizations as they are at the moment, do you think there needs to be a certain style of approach to enterprise architecting in Spain as opposed to elsewhere? Are there any particular local issues or cultural things that would affect how it would be approached?
Well, the main problem is that as we have had very soft years, the companies have not hired people. And in fact, the unemployment in Spain for young people is more than 50%. And that's one of the problems that we have to bring here young architects, because there are no young architects in the companies in Spain. They have not hired anyone in the last 5-6 years. So this is the main problem. We have to start making these groups of people interested in architecture and be hired by the companies to start doing that, because there are a few architects that are doing their job as IT architects now. Some CIOs are thinking about creating these enterprise architect groups. Some of them have created, but they have not a very clear idea about what enterprise architecture is. So we have to do more communication and more awareness about what is this, that, and especially for the people. What is that? What it represents? How they can work? This is a career they can follow, and start giving this idea to the companies in Spain that the only way to go out of the crisis and to progress in their companies is to know where to go. And this is what enterprise architecture is about. So, but I think I'm positive and optimistic in this way. But we need that these companies hire young people, because it is the only way. So let's hope that in the next months, years, they will hire more young people to create this architecture practice and start going on.
Yeah. One of the things that we hear when we hold these events at different places around the world is that the value of enterprise architecture is often more clearly seen when in situations where maybe there is a need to start reducing cost or building from a situation where there's had to be a lot of cost. So maybe the time is right for Spain right now. Let's hope so. I should have said before we started, if there are questions from anyone in the audience, then please do let us know, raise your hand or something, and Fernando has kindly agreed to translate if there's a need to. I know we've got one over here. I can see Sonia won't need to translate, will you? So, but if you could say who you are and where you're from, Chris. I know who you are. But
it is working, thank you. I'm Chris Ford with the Open Group. I'm the VP for Enterprise Architecture. You've mentioned this, but I wanted to ask the folks directly, what advice would you give colleagues trying to transition into the enterprise architecture or a domain architecture role based on what you understand the role to be today versus what you understood before? If I was, and I wish I was your age, okay, looking to transition into this kind of career, what advice would you give to me?
I think that you used to focus or in IT or in business. So my advice is that the engineering, the people that is studying degrees like computer science or
will be a deep knowledge of the industry, not only IT. It's necessary to understand the industry involved in the IT project, and this will be my advice.
Well, my advice would be first to warn him that he's going to run into a lot of work, a lot of trouble, a lot of pains, not sleeping. That would be the first one. And the second one, I would say that what's nice of being in this part is that I think it's one of the parts where you can influence the most, that you can talk to the people in the company that decide, and that you can bring your ideas and actually see them change. Sometimes when you work in a little part, you can do little changes. If you go higher, higher influence you have, and that's something that I personally like, and I see how it reflects after.
Sonia, sorry.
Hi. I'm Sonia.
Was working. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Sonia Gonzalez from the Open Group. I'm the forum director for the Architecture Forum. And I have a question for you about enterprise architecture. It's really about business and strategy. So how you define any kind of approach or strategy into the association to make the market understand that it's really a business issue and not only a technology issue?
Well, in the Spanish chapter, we try to show these practitioners that it's the combination of business and technology. Sometimes someone say that it's better, or you might be most focused on business and transformation, and even you don't have to have a broad knowledge about IT. Others have just the opposite opinion, but what we're trying to do is to show the IT architects that they have to acquire business skills. It's not only IT. You have to succeed as an enterprise architect. You have to start, as Mario said, start to thinking about the business, about the industries, about the problems that our clients have in the daily business, and in this way you can be able to make this link between IT and business. This is something that in our efforts to show what is enterprise architect to our associates and the companies and the Spanish companies is something that we try to show them, not only the IT but the business, the transformations, the linking, and what is the traditional enterprise architect. But this is something that, and this is what I'm worried. The young architects, they are focused on IT, and for them, and this is like when I was like them, IT is everything that I need. I'm very comfortable in being an IT architect because I love technology and this is what I like. But in some point, you have to receive some advice from senior architects to show you that there is something more, and that maybe in the next year the focus will be upper in more in business than in IT. But someone has to show you and have to teach you and to show you the path, because you by yourself, you are very comfortable in IT, and probably you don't know what is that there are other things, and you can have another careers and other paths, and it's important to show them that this is the case and you have these opportunities.
I know that Juan had mentioned that the local chapter did a study with universities to gauge levels of interest in enterprise architecture here, and I know from talking with members of the chapter before, Spain has some very top business schools, some of the highest ranked business schools in the world. Are you sensing any interest from them, or is it more from the undergraduate school?
This is a lesson learned, because we focus our study on the traditional careers, telecommunications, informatics, and so on. And we left the business studies, or these academies, out of our study. maybe you have to focus in these business studies and these business schools, because maybe some of the people that are accessing these studies come from technology, yeah. And this can be the perfect mix for this promotion of enterprise architecture. So this is something that this year we like to do, something like the same that we did last year, but more focused on business schools. And we'll wait and learn about that.
Okay. I think there was another question, one here and one over there.
Mohammed from Information Technology Authority, Oman. My question is to the Open Group people here, the CEO and the Spain chapter. Do you think the enterprise architecture should be part of the IT program or should be enforced in the university programs, especially the computer science, computer engineering? And especially here we want to balance between the ideas that, from the business aspect, the students are not that having the good experience in the business part, while they are mainly focusing on the IT and technology. And also, if you keep them without awareness in their study, when they go out, they will be new and fresh, especially we heard today that people, they are struggling when they go to the market and so on.
Yeah, I think, should I have a go at that first one? What we've seen around the world is that there is no doubt a history of architects coming primarily from IT, and that the universities therefore have not really focused on enterprise architecture. Now there are exceptions. We are seeing whole enterprise architecture programs being offered by universities around the world. The one that gets called out very often is Penn State in the US, but we know that there are a lot of others, particularly at the postgraduate level, that are actually offering enterprise architecture courses specifically to deal with the kind of issues that you're raising and the awareness of, and prepare people for a career in enterprise architecture. I think in terms of should it be part of a computer science degree or equivalent, then I would say it would be, but I'm probably prejudiced in that. But I think equipping people who are leaving university, who are thinking at least of a career in architecture, whether it's domain architecture or enterprise architecture, equipping them with something before they leave is no doubt a good thing. And some universities are, in the Open Group we talk about kind of TOGAF being, TOGAF training or certification being a sort of entry level to architecture, and then working up along to the OpenCA certification at the various levels there. And some of the universities are now offering TOGAF training inside the university as a module for a computer science degree. So we're starting to see some of that around the world. I can't speak for what exists in Spain, but I'm guessing that isn't happening yet, but might happen soon. But certainly, as I mentioned earlier, a very common question is, okay, so I think I'm interested in this. How do I get there? Because I don't really have the training. And I think one of the things that the association has to do on a global basis is help capture that landscape of relevant experience, certifications, and training that will allow architects to progress from coming right out of university right the way through a career in architecture, or to transition into that career at some point from some other field that they're in. And that's something that we need to get our arms around. There are a few organisations looking at it, and ourselves included, but I think it will be helpful to capture that landscape. And the thing I'd add is what I've found when we've tried to approach that is it's very difficult into areas of project management and strategy, and you know, being able to know at least a bit about lots of different subjects, all of those things are relevant. So it's very hard to say, oh, well, you don't need to worry about this, you don't need to worry about that, because most things you do. So it is quite hard to capture, but it is definitely something that we need to focus on as an organization.
But I think that we don't have to rely only on the university studies or postgraduate studies, because the enterprise architecture, to be an enterprise architecture is a long way, and you have to learn many things and to practice years and years. And what we are trying to do in the Spanish chapter is to show the different companies, Spanish companies, the value of the architecture and how they can establish a career and the career path. And I remember that 2 years ago I was talking with the CTO of a very big retail company, and because they were interested only in governance. But they showed that, well, you have to govern something and someone. So where are your architects? Do you have some career for them? Do you have some levels? Do you know that the Open Group has some certification level that you can follow and a very structured way of achieving this certification? No, I don't know what's that. And explain to these guys what is that. And they were very surprised that they didn't know about that. So they start thinking about that, and they start organizing the architecture department around these specialties and about this certification. They started to set objectives of certification for their own people. So they quickly realized that has value yeah. for their people and for their company. So this is something that we try to do. Not only for the universities, this is important also, but also for the companies, for the architects that are now in the companies, how they can see beyond their daily work. Because most of them are doing their job, but they don't have this broad vision. They don't know about all the Open Group certifications and programs and so on. And this is some of our tasks. Show these companies that there is a lot of another world there mm-hmm. that can improve not only companies, but the people working in the companies. They can provide them more value, and that's important.
Absolutely. There was one more question over here. Yeah.
Hello, I'm Josip Špaleta from Croatia. Well, you all stressed that enterprise architecture is part of business or connected to business. So what do you think if enterprise architect should be industry specialized, for example, in healthcare, government, or whatever, or it should be industry agnostic? Thank you.
Yes. Yeah, it is.
It needs
yeah.
translation
yeah.
or not translation? Is it clear?
My personal view is that there's a role for there's a role for specialism within enterprise architecture and experience within particular verticals. But a lot of what we talk about as what is involved in enterprise architecture, the skills involved, they are to me industry agnostic. They're not dependent on one or another. Obviously, experience in a particular industry is something that follows. And there are, I think there are things like industry-specific reference models that get created that are helpful. But I think the skills involved in enterprise architecture are across, I don't know all, but certainly most industries, would be my personal view.
I like to ask these
yeah.
guys if you feel that in your present job you have opportunities to acquire deep skills in one specific industry, or your present job is absolutely cross industry. What do you feel?
I think it's more cross, and I think it's more important to be deep in an industry, in a specific industry, because in this way you can learn or you can projects that you have seen in other companies about the same industry. And as I told before, for that I think it would be very important to know this industry from inside a company of that industry.
When I was an application architect, I am focusing in the financial service sector. But nowadays, in my current position is a cross-industry role. In my opinion, I think it's necessary to split the enterprise architect role in several areas, like in financial, healthcare, and other industry.
Well, since I work in the infrastructure part mainly, I consider myself a kind of cross, but I see I'm a little bit far from the business, so I think if I was closer to the business, I would be more industry-oriented. And also, I think what would be good is if you know the knowledge of the industry, you can show what other clients are doing to provide other points of view, which is always something interesting.
Okay, and the second question regarding experience. Since you guys don't have gray beards, do you have problem if people consider you green for this discipline? Usually people consider enterprise architects to have gray beards, glasses, and so on, but you're not that kind. So do you have problem with your status of enterprise architect in these ages? Thank you.
I think it takes several years to us be an enterprise architect. So in my case, I am starting and I can't consider myself an enterprise architect yet. So I don't have that experience.
Myself, since I think a lot, I need to learn a lot and to have a lot of point of view to be an enterprise architect, I think I'm a little bit far and I need more experience in that sense.
So your point is really, is there a credibility issue when you're starting out? Yeah. At what point do you suddenly become credible? It's an interesting one, I guess. But I would say it's from delivering value or being seen to be able to be part of a team that has done that, and then you build your brand, which is plug for my session after lunch, but it's all that kind of you've got to start somewhere. And
you are industry agnostic. You have to have a lot of experience in government, I don't know, banking, whatever. And I think that without gray beard, it's hard to have this knowledge. Thank you.
I know there was a question towards the back there. Been enthusiastically waving his arm around. Yeah. So there's a
hi, Paul Homan, IBM. I classify you guys as digital natives. I don't know if that translates, Fernando, if there's another term for digital native. Does that make sense to you guys? I mean, shake or nod your heads. But, you know, Twitter, Facebook, very comfortable with all that kind of interaction. What needs would you have of the Open Group? What challenges would you put back in terms of enterprise architecture and TOGAF and things because you are digital natives? What do you think that means? It's something different, potentially.
Does that make sense? So did you understand the question? I think if I can summarize poorly, probably, but you're of an age, a generation that's used to the digital world and social media and all that goes with it. So what can the Open Group do, or what can industry do to what are your expectations? Are they different to what they might have been if you'd been older? Is that a rough assessment? dragged kicking and screaming into it, but you have the it's natural to think of things digitally and think of screens being touch screens and things like that. What would you expect would be different, I think, is the question from the industry groups, that do you have expectations that are different than if you were older? It's hard to answer because you don't know what the expectations of the older guys are, but
translate this question for you guys? Spanish?
Yes, please.
La pregunta realmente es, ¿hasta qué punto, siendo vosotros nativos digitales, siendo vosotros personas que habéis estado en un entorno donde a lo mejor todas estas nuevas influencias de las nuevas corrientes os están impactando, cómo veis realmente si esto es un dinamizador para las enterprise architectures, para las arquitecturas empresariales, o si realmente esto no tiene mucha influencia en lo que es una arquitectura empresarial? Como está diciendo, si realmente la aproximación es desde arriba, desde una aproximación TOGAF, desde una aproximación de arquitectura empresarial, o si realmente esto puede ser un dinamizador para las arquitecturas empresariales, el hecho de que todas estas tendencias estén juntas. No sé si queda más claro así.
I think it's a difficult question. But in my case, I use social media to be informed about the things that happen in the world. So in this way, it can help to know about business, about market trends, about some areas that in other case you don't have access. And maybe with Facebook, Twitter, you can see in an overview what is happening.
I have a question for you and for Juan. Is ready the currently technology is ready to assume thousands or millions of new users, and is there a scalability of data model for assume this new system of engagement?
I'm the wrong person to answer that question, but I think it's certainly certainly an issue that we hear raised, is how do we keep up, whether it's with big data or anything else. But the technology usually manages to keep up, but what we do with it and how useful that becomes and how we scale to manage that is the problem that I hear expressed. I think one of the things I detected in Paul's question, but may or may not have been there, was there's a certain way of learning about enterprise architecture currently, particularly TOGAF. There are ways of learning it and then taking an exam, and maybe things could be more digital in their approach for you and your those that follow you entering the profession. Are there ways of, it's already an online exam, for example, to take TOGAF as an exam, but are there different ways of learning that are more like what you're used to in the tools that you use? So I think that's certainly something to think about for those who are providing the training, and for us at the Open Group to think about how we can take that next step. So
we try to do something like that, yeah, in our learning programs, and it was some kind of interactive system, mm-hmm, to teach the young architects how to proceed in real case. So it was like a computer game.
Yeah.
So you assume the role of an architect. needed, and you have to design something, and the system was guiding you and proposing some challenge and evaluating your success or not, and it was really, it was not a big success. Some people said that it was too simple, others said that it was a waste of time, others say that it was the future. It was mixed, and we are reevaluating how to do that. But at the beginning, it was like a good approach for this kind of digital people that have won in these systems. But it was not black or white. It was different different responses. So I don't know if for learning TOGA, for example, or for learning for an OpenSea certification, these new technologies can provide something of real value or not. It's something that we have to see. We have to test and get the feedback to see if it's good or not. But it's I think it's worth to try to do that.
Okay. Any more questions from the... There's one in the middle there, I think, Fernando.
Thank you. Abdel Al-Qadi from Shift Technologies, Dubai. I just want to go back to the question about whether TOGAF is industry-specific or not. Actually, if we look at the, if we analyze what it takes to do architecture today, we see that there are three key elements in delivering architecture value. The first one is you need to understand the methods, and that's where the TOGAF part, especially the ADM component of TOGAF, is essential. And that is definitely industry agnostic. So the methodology dimension of a project, yes, can be independent of the industry in which we are delivering the architecture work. The second component is the knowledge of the industry itself. So this is where accelerators like business reference models, application reference models, and other tools can be actually very useful to guide and support the execution. Those can actually bridge the gap in experience and help the architect deliver more effective solutions to the customer. But those usually take time to build, and gray hair is definitely required to achieve them. The third element that I think is also very important is communication, knowing how to communicate the value. And this also takes experience and relates to attributes that are personal in nature and are hard to train because they relate to the personality of the person delivering. So if we look at the three elements, the methodology, the industry knowledge, and the personality or the communication skills, I think there is room to initiate the training and to help accelerate the evolution of that. But there's a lot that would still require time and experience, and for sure mistakes to become an effective architect. So one just last recommendation. A life insurance would be a good sponsor for the Open Group. I think with our age average, it can be a good option.
There's a thought. There's a good thought. I think we've got one more question over here, Fernando, and then that will be... Thank you.
Yeah, my name is Saif Al-Khoury, and from Abu Dhabi Gas. Initially, I would like to thank all the focus for their courage. Really, we appreciate it to be on the stage. That's achievement. And my question, I'm wondering whether you are using any tools and whether it's helping you. Is it mandatory to have a tool or not, from your experience? Thank you.
What do you think? Are you using any tool in your daily work now?
Architecture tools?
In my company, we had a tool for enterprise architect, I think, called software system architect, a rational system architect, but I don't use it.
Well, in my case, I know there's also solutions for or tools inside, but the truth is that we normally don't use it.
Interesting.
No, it's
it's difficult to find the right tool, and because to use a tool for enterprise architecture like the ones that we have here, you have to have some knowledge about what you are doing, and this knowledge comes from training and for experience. So these guys, for example, are just beginning and they are doing IT architecture. So maybe these tools are too big, too complex for them. And maybe with some PowerPoint or Servicio, it's just enough for them. But I am convinced that an architect has to use tools and has to be an expert using these tools, the proper tools for the job. But it's difficult to find the right one.
There are some exhibitors outside who would like to show you that theirs is the right one. So do go and see them. I think there was there one, Maggie, in the middle? Was one more question, and then we'll be at lunch at that point.
Thank you. This will be a very short question. I'm Brian from Huawei, and this question is relating to some vertical specific. A while ago, I hear that there are interest from very organizations asking for EA. So I would like to ask, within Spain, do you notice any telecom companies adopting the enterprise architecture disciplines? And if yes, what are the key drivers? Thank you.
Well, in fact, they have adopted the standard framework for telco, but I have experience, at least in Vodafone, where we try to develop an enterprise architecture with no much success, because they stopped as an application portfolio assessment, and that's all we did. And the other one, that is France Telecom, yes, they try to do something because they see value about the enterprise architecture, because they have there is a very gap, or there was a big gap between applications and business and technology, and they feel that they have to have some traceability, because it's hard for them to have this gap. And about Telefonica, they started something, but I don't know if in the last years they have succeeded in enterprise architecture. But my feeling is that in this sector specifically, they have not had many attempts or many tries to establish a good enterprise architecture, and it's a pity, because they need it. Because as you know, they have been many fusions and acquisitions in the last years, and it's a mess what they have, and they don't have a very clear idea about the whole architecture and what is important, what not, and what is the transition that they have to do. So it's room for improvement, a lot of room for improvement in this sector now.
Excuse me, I think I can provide some input about Juan also regarding the telco.
I have just a follow-up question.
Yes.
So what do you think has been the key inhibitor in these telcos? Is it culture, or is it people not reluctant to change, or?
No, it's speed. Because creating and documenting the whole enterprise architecture takes months or years. And in the last years, the telco companies have been in a hurry to do things quickly and with profit and with low cost, and they had no time to start thinking about creating this enterprise architecture. So maybe now that the market is more or less stable in terms of the companies that we have now here in Spain, maybe it's the right time to start doing this job. But in the last years, it was really crazy with many acquisitions, and they had no time for that, really.
Right, so we are out of time, but I know, Judith, is it a question or a comment, or is it one quick one then, please?
Where do you see enterprise architecture being done mostly? Right, so mostly being all the different domains. Because what I'm seeing is lots of service providers learning and understanding enterprise architecture, but very few unique businesses outside of the IT industry that we're in. And I wondered what your views were about why that was happening, whether it was because inside genuine, let's call them customer sort of areas, they actually are looking for services from other people to provide the architecture skill. question, just to give you that clarity, is where do you see those enterprise architecture skills? Out in the service communities or actually in the organisations that you work for inside, and how you see that balance developing over time?
So, you're talking about Spain, are you, Judith?
Yes.
Specific to Spain, right. I think the question is do you have experience or see the enterprise architecture work being in companies themselves or outsourced to service providers? And it's mostly the service providers that are providing those services. And obviously, I think you work for a service provider, so you...
No, the good thing is that we are seeing this interest in the final clients in different sectors. And this is something that we didn't see in the last years. So I think this is because they are realizing that they have to do something and they have to improve something in their companies to succeed and to go out of this crazy crisis. But they don't know what to do. And they have heard and they have read that enterprise architecture can help them in making this transformation. So they are requesting help in doing that. And this is in the final clients, not in the service providers or the consulting firms, but we are receiving these requests from the final clients in different sectors. It's not one only sector. It's different sectors that are feeling that they have to do something. They think that enterprise architecture can help them in understanding what to do and in providing the roadmap about how to do that, and they're asking for help. So I think big opportunity now in Spain for enterprise architecture.
So I know we are out of time, and I know Alan would like to do some wrapping up, but I'd really like to express our thanks for you all for coming up here. It's a big step. As I said earlier, think of it as career development or